songs celebrated in tonight's documentary feature, The Bells Hill Beat, and it comes pretty highly recommended, apparently.
Hey, everybody, this is Dave Grohl from the Foo Fighters. You're about to hear the best documentary the BBC has ever done on Radio 1, The Bells Hill Beat.
All the lovely little streets and the villages, you really do get the same optimism which attends marriages.
Just. Buck Fast was a bit blasé by that point. You used to just see guys up in Bells Hill Cross. Blutter.
Larcher was always one of those places that I'd heard of, didn't have a clue what it looked like, and it was far too far away to justify visiting.
I mean, for Prince, it was the closest he could get to joining the BMX Bandits, because he did ask. And we knocked them back, straight right in the crest of our wave.
Lanarkshire is basically the land of kings. Kings, 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 kings.
Teenage fan club.
The Delgados.
Bell Sebastian.
Superstar.
Travis.
The Passos.
The Soup Dragons.
The Yummy Fuck.
Apart from being Scottish, all these bands have something in common. Lanarkshire. Lanarkshire. Lanarkshire is a county in Scotland between Glasgow and Edinburgh that takes in a number of small towns and villages. Despite being relatively small in size, the area's produced dozens of musicians and songwriters who have made arguably some of the most important music to come out of the UK. I'm Steve McKenna. Welcome to the Bells Hill Beat.
This is Norman from Teenage Fan Club, and all I can think of when I think of Lanarkshire is post-industrial wastelands.
I was going to use that for there.
You know, I grew up in Bells Hill, and I think it's a pretty grim place. There's not a lot going on there, you know. It's probably a bit better now, and there are more jobs, but I think of Bells Hill 15 years ago, there was not a lot happening there, no future. Now, there were a lot of punks in Bells Hill.
The Bells Hill Norman's referring to is a tiny town at the heart of Lanarkshire, centred between Motherwell, Coatbridge and Hamilton. If you drew a circle round the lot of them, it would be about 3 miles wide. But despite its size, the area's had a huge number of success stories, and not just recently. In the 70s, there was the sensational Alex Harvey band, Marmalade, Middle of the Road, and members of Nazareth. Into the 80s with the Bluebells, Hipsway, Hue and Cry, Sheena Easton, and members of Texas and Simple Minds. And in the 90s, it's no different.
This is Plasma Song from Mogwai. There's hundreds and hundreds of brilliant bands that have came out of Lanarkshire. My favourite Lanarkshire band's probably the Jesus and Mary Chain, even though William Reid's a wanker. But they're not really, because I've decided my favourite band for Lanarkshire is actually the Yummy Fur from Blantyre. They're absolutely brilliant. See some of the places in Lanarkshire? Do you know what I mean? I mean, we've been all over the place. Tokyo, New York, good places. Sydney, good places. Aye. I mean, they are good. You stow about, you see some nice things. But you're driving about Lanarkshire, you just look about and you can just smell the glory. It's paved with gold. It's amazing. You better smile.
This is James from the Supernaturals. I would sum up the Lanarkshire sound in maybe a record. Say Serious Drugs by BMX Bandits, because on that record it had the singer from Teenage Fan Club, BMX Bandits, and Joe McLennan from Superstar, and it was a fantastic record.
I said I don't think I can take it much longer. She said maybe your tablet should be stronger. Get some Serious Drugs.
Hi, this is Roddy from Idlewild. If you're talking about the music that comes out of Lanarkshire in recent years, a good starting point is the BMX Bandits. Just because of the number of people who've been in the Bandits and gone on to form their own bands. Norman from Teenage Fan Club, Sean from the Soup Dragons, who's now in the High Fidelity, Joe from Superstar, Stevie from Bell and Sebastian, and Eugene, who's in the Vaseline's, the Pastels, and Captain America. I don't know, you wonder how they ended up in the same place.
My name's Joe McLendon, and I've been in them all, just about. BMX Bandits, the Boy Hairdressers, Superstar, and loads more. We actually all met busking, believe it or not. Two separate factions. There's a crowd of us from Motherwell, myself and Jim, who's in Superstar as well. And we did all the kind of Glenn Miller stuff and all that, saxophones and all that. We were pretty good. And just up the road from us, in Buchanan Street, 100 yards, there was these guys from Bells Hill, and they all had dungarees on and funny haircuts. And that was Douglas Stewart and Norman Blake and Sean Dixon as well. And we ended up getting the same train back home out to the Shire. And that was basically how we all kind of hooked up. Maybe now with the kind of newer wave of things with the Chemical Underground thing and all that, people would find it interesting that these things have happened from, you know, in the same kind of place.
The Delgados formed Chemical Underground Records more than 5 years ago. One of their early successes were Biss, and since then they've kept a local feel to the label, releasing their own material, as well as stuff from the likes of Arab Strap and Mogwai.
We knew Mogwai, like, you know, to talk to and stuff, so when they were looking for a label, you know, it was logical for them to come to us. Stuart Henderson from the Delgados and Chemical Underground Records, and I'm with my colleague Emma Pollock in our offices. It's a friendship thing for us in a lot of respects, and bumping into people in pubs, because we don't have any roving A&R people driving around the country in Mondeos looking for good bands. So it does tend to be people that we know or that we bump into in the pub and stuff.
Money generates money. If you've already got a setup and you've already got a reputation, then if you are a band and you want to actually be heard, there's already media interest, and there's this network that exists in certain places you can go to, and pretty much every night there will be a bunch of people that if you got into conversation you would undoubtedly find yourself a few members or a few potential members of a band. It's really good that way. If you're a band and you come into Glanshire, there are opportunities there that maybe don't exist or aren't as accessible in other parts.
The combination of business and musical talent has proved highly successful for Chemical Underground. And as they're not yet signing bands who don't drink in the same pubs as them, you could be forgiven for thinking you'd either have to be from Lanarkshire or at least be a short bus or train trip away to get ahead. James and Kenny from The Supernaturals.
Maybe we should have grown up in Lanarkshire, we'd have done a bit better.
Period, and certainly Scottish music, you definitely had to have a Lanarkshire member. The more the merrier, you know, but 10 Lanarkshire members, you're probably going to do very well and get a lot of press and write a lot of good songs. And none of the Supernaturals are from Lanarkshire. So we didn't get anywhere to start with, and then we get dropped.
I mean, maybe there's uranium under the ground there or something that's causing people to be mutated into sort of very musical people or something, I don't know. Have you got any ideas, Ken?
Like a lot of areas that seem to produce good musicians, so there's not a great deal to stimulate your mind, and so they're probably sitting in their bedrooms working hard on songs and getting good at playing the guitar, things like that.
My name is Douglas T. Stewart, leader of a band called BMX Bandits. I think definitely a lot of Lanarkshire is quite run down. A lot of the industry has gone, so it's quite a depressed area in some ways. But I think there's a real tradition in rock and roll, that a lot of the best rock and roll has come out of areas that are not quite as affluent as other areas. I think it's something like there's more need to an escape, whether that's escape to the reality of a big mansion or just a kind of escape in your own mind to somewhere different, to an alternative place. And the rock and roll world is certainly a different place. Suddenly the Soup Dragons, I think, were really the first group that were starting getting a lot of acclaim and a lot of notice. Then I think it really made us kind of stand up and say, well, I want to do it as well, you know, because we knew each other all very well, and if one of us could achieve it, it was like a victory for all of us.
Freedom! I'm free, do what I want, any old time. I said I'm free,
You're listening to the Bells Hill Beat on Radio 1.
See people escaping. I mean, I think that's why there's such a fascination with Bells Hill. I could do something that I enjoy and actually spend the rest of my life not having to get a job and, like, work in a steel yard or something. I had no interest in that. I mean, I've always been a dreamer, and sometimes my dreams came true. I'm Sean Dixon, born and bred in Bells Hill. I started playing in bands when I was about 14, 15, and I've been in Soup Dragons. Love is such a game. Love is such a game. Love is
such a game. And now, Sean's the leader of the High Fidelity.
To people in our countries, there's going to be a they think a scene, whereas the people that actually come from that place realise there's not, you know, there never was and there never will be. It was just a kind of coincidence of, like, bands from the same area, you know, Chemical Underground. The fact that they're under the one record label and they come from the same place and the record label's from the same place, of course that's going to look like a certain kind of scene going on there, but it likely isn't. Like-minded souls again.
My name is Moccasin.
This is Plasmatron
from the band Mogwai. There's not a scene until you leave it. And then when you go over and try to explain to all these people in Germany that there isn't really a scene, they get all confused or annoyed or something. So they kind of think that there is, but there isn't. They're so different, all the music.
It's a pain in the arse having to explain to people that we don't live in a big house with Belle and Sebastian and bloody Biss all sort of, like, arguing over the milk for the cornflakes. The whole thing from Lanarkshire, there's just a lot of good bands from Lanarkshire. It's not, like, a scene at all.
From the area say that they're not part of any conscious scene, but coming from close-knit communities within a mile or two of each other, it would be hard not to be aware of who else is making music around you. Plasmatron from Mogwai.
There's certainly a kind of lineage of bands through the years from Lanarkshire. There's quite a lot of pretty decent ones. Growing up and knowing that there's been bands like the Mary Chain or whatever and the Fannies and all that, you kind of certainly, like, if you're from Edinburgh, what are you going to think? Oh, I'm going to be like, goodbye, Mr. McKenzie. Do you know what I mean? At least you know that there's been some decent bands that have managed to kind of get records out and not be shite. Whereas a lot of places, there's no history of decency whatsoever. Like in Edinburgh, they should actually stop the sale of musical instruments to the general public because they make the world sound worse.
An exception, of course, Edinburgh-based Idlewild, but then they do admit to being influenced by Lanarkshire.
I'm Roddy, and we're currently on the fourth floor of the Portrait Hotel in Isle of Skye. Probably the biggest sort of Lanarkshire sort of Bells Hill band, sort of, and to me the most famous one, probably Teenage Fan Club, you know. Being sort of 16 years old, you've never really checked out the Birds as a big star, because you just haven't really. I mean, my dad liked the Birds, but that was kind of an indication not to listen to stuff. You know, when you're younger, you don't listen to what your parents listen to. When there's a cool band like Teenage Fan Club, having the name checks of stuff they like, when you're 16, or still now actually, you go and check it out, you know, go and see what it's like. Melodies and harmonies and things like that. Like that, that's what I love, listening to music like that anyway. It just baffles me how people can do that sometimes. But, you know, the Teenage Fan Club, to bring sort of, you know, sort of humour and sort of, I mean, they're just great, you know.
This is Norman from Teenage Fan Club.
It's flattering if people say they're influenced by you, isn't it? And it's really nice, we appreciate that, but we haven't had any sort of cool people want to cover our songs or anything. It's only Phil Collins that likes us. He's like our celebrity fan.
No, he's not, is he?
Phil Collins is a big fan of ours, yeah. He tells the story about being in Heathrow Airport and he's in the departure lounge and he heard the song. He thought, that's a great song. And so he heard another one and he realised it was all from the same album. And he went off and he searched around the building until he found out where it was coming from. And at the very end of the story, he says, and it was a great group from Scotland called Teenage Fan Club. It was pretty good, that, really. We're hoping to maybe get Collins over to do the big fill at the start of the album, to open the album, you know. The latest comeback album.
Aren't the only band appealing to middle-of-the-road artists. Rod Stewart covered a superstar song, and Travis count among their many celebrity fans former folk singer turned comedian Billy Connolly. A love of melody in the Lanarkshire and indeed Glasgow area has often helped its underground bands reach a wide appeal.
My name is Eugene Kelly. I played in several bands from the Fastalines to the BMX Bandits. I was in the Pastels for a while. Then I went on to be in Captain America, who then transformed themselves into Eugenius. And now I'm a solo artist under the name Eugene Kelly. I'm not from that area. I'm from the east end of Glasgow, which isn't that far away. It's only about 13, 14 miles. I was lucky that I managed to hook up with these guys from Bells Hill, and through hanging out with these people I was kind of introduced to lots of different bands and old bands and stuff and records, and maybe getting through them, getting to know people like Stephen Passwell a lot better, who released the first Vaseline's single. So I think if I'd stayed in the East End and just hung about, I wouldn't be talking to you now. Fastlane's released two singles initially on 53rd and 3rd, which was the independent record label from Edinburgh, which also released the Groove Outlaw Numbers and the Boy Hairdressers, which became Teenage Fan Club, and the BMX Bandits. And somehow copies of the Fastlane's records managed to get to Seattle into the hands of Kurt Cobain, who became a fan. Nirvana went on to cover three songs by the Vaseline's: Son of a Gun, Molly Slips, and Jesus Doesn't Want Me for a Sunbeam.
This was written by the Vaseline's. Well, it's a rendition of an old Christian song, I think. But we do it the Vaseline's way.
Through that, I managed to get to tour with them, with my band Captain America. We supported them around Britain. And got to meet them and get to know them a bit. And shebang.
Jesus, don't want me for something.
Hey everybody, this is Dave Grohl from the Foo Fighters, live from New York City. And you're listening to the Bells Hill Beat on Radio 1. Well, when I first joined Nirvana, I was introduced to a band called the Vaseline's that Kurt and Chris were huge fans of, and we wound up covering some of their songs, and the music was so soothing. It was really wonderful, and unlike any music I'd ever really listened to before, I was really kind of a punk rock guy. And I remember the first time I heard the Vaseline's, I just thought, this is beautiful, soothing, genuinely pretty music, you know. Well, I think with all of those bands, the most important thing was melody and harmony. It wasn't so much musicianship, and it wasn't so much volume, and it wasn't so much image or posturing or anything like that. It was just who could one-up the next person on making the sweetest possible melody. Because those things were so ridiculously candy-ass sweet. Teenage Fan Club were shameless with some of their melodies, you know, and lyrics too. I mean, you can only say I love you so many times, but there just there didn't seem to be a limit on any of that. And it was great, and that was liberating. And those songs stuck in your f***ing head forever, too.
The influence of the bands from Lanarkshire can also be heard closer to home. Belle and Sebastian, complete with former BMX Bandit member Stevie Jackson, found a degree of international fame when guest vocalist Monica Queen from Motherwell band Thrum laced this track with her soaring vocals. But that wasn't the first time they'd been touched by Lanarkshire.
Let's see you kick the games. All the girls in the state. Do a challenge in style. Bell Sebastian HQ, which is just a little office in Glasgow. My name is Richard Coburn, and Lanarkshire, what can you say? It's a bit like Memphis, but it's in Scotland. There is a kind of underlying sound, but that's evolved since maybe 10 years ago and stuff, because it's been a long-going scene. But yeah, bands like Big Star and Originally, I think, were influential on quite a few of the bands from there.
Have any of the bands coming out of there influenced you in any way?
Yeah, well, I'm originally from Perth, and there used to be a venue called the Twa Tams, and I remember not a lot of bands used to come through there, but about 10 years ago, bands like the BMX Bandits and Thrum and other bands started playing and coming through Perth. I remember reading about them but never seen them, and saw them and thought, oh wow, great, let's get a band together. Bell Sebastian.
Stuart from the Delgados.
The time that I became aware of the whole thing about them being all from Bell's Hill and stuff was round about when Bandwagon-esque had come out, which was pretty much when the Teenage Fan Club thing really kind of hit hard. And, you know, I was into the BMX Bandits and sort of the Super Dragons to a lesser extent. And I was, unashamedly, I was like a Teenage Fan Club acolyte for a while. I'd go and see them everywhere and I thought they were fantastic. And it did rub off, and as a result, I was in a shite band for a couple of years that sounded disturbingly like Teenage Fan Club on the worst day of their life. Which thankfully I was ejected from with Paul and Alan, and we went on to form the Delgados.
Douglas from the BMX Bandits.
There was a time when there was a real musical link. There was a real time when it seemed all of the bands from the area were trying to sound like Teenage Fan Club. But now, musically, the link is a much more tenuous one, and I think that's a good thing. There's a really, really wide diversity of music coming out. And I feel really inspired by it. It's nice that the guys from Chemical Underground were saying they were kind of inspired by what we were doing earlier, because I'm inspired by what we've done since. And just the kind of attitude, and I think they've taken it further than if we were the first generation of bands when we took it. And I think there is links. I'm not sure if it's kind of melodically or if it's a stylistic thing. I think it is more just really an attitude thing that links us.
Whether it's attitude, style or melody that ties all the bands from Lanarkshire together, in this country, the link has gone unnoticed. But not so in Japan. Here's Joe from Superstar and Plasmatron from Mogwai.
When you go to Japan, you kind of believe the records that are in the shops. Things like Yummy Fur Lungleg and all that, really kind of quite underground Lanarkshire bands. People are totally into it.
One of the times I was over there, I went into this shop Wave in Tokyo, which is one of the biggest music stores, and there was this huge display, all these records I'd played on, and at the top, the head in Japanese said, the godfather of Scottish pop, and there was a big picture in my face, you know. It's just nuts. It's totally nuts, you know. I remember the first time we went to Japan, you're the other side of the world, and it's really exciting and stuff, and all these people want to get in touch with you, and you think, I'm never going to be back here. I was giving out my address, I was still staying with my parents at the time, and got mail and stuff, and you reply and kept in touch with everybody. And this one day I came home to find that there was four Japanese girls in my mum and dad's house. They were on holiday in London and they thought they would just go and see where Joe-san stayed. So they travelled from London to Glasgow and then got a train from Glasgow to Hollytown and then like wandered round Hollytown until they found Tweed Lane in Hollytown. And I hadn't been in, and they were in the house for like 2 hours. I walked in and they started crying and stuff, you know. And my dad just grabbed me by the collar and he's like, right, you, up the stairs. So he's like asking what's going on, you know. So then my mum, who's a teacher, she came home and obviously there was a bit of a language barrier, you know. So my mum, being the sensible one, thought that they all might need the toilet because they'd been sitting for so long. And she kind of ushered them up the stairs and opened the bathroom door and showed them the toilet and they all just bowed and followed her back down the stairs. It's like, try this 3 times, you know. I think they must think we've got some kind of tradition of showing people, you're showing off your toilet to people.
The musical talent of the area is without a doubt unique. And something else that's unique to Lanarkshire is its sales of Buckfast. If you haven't heard of it, it's a tonic wine made by monks in Devon. And over 90% of its worldwide sales are in Lanarkshire. It's quite sweet and also quite thick. And it's known to many of the bands as Electric Soup, Bucky, or simply The Bottle. Jesus, you're such a love. Could there be a link link between this unique drinking pattern and the unique music. Richard from Belle and Sebastian.
You can actually get it on tap in certain places, I have to say. Which is, and when it first hit Scotland, this area in particular, there was such a problem with it that the local council had to get funding from Buckfast Abbey to actually put people into counselling and stuff to sink it off. Which, I think that's quite influential. It still is. I still see quite a few bands, newer bands coming from there that still partake in the influential juice. Puts your mind on another level, I think. These artistic juices start flowing a bit better, I think, when you've had a bottle or two. Especially when you're playing live. It gets a bit more exciting. You kind of get out yourself a wee bit and act it.
Have been known to sip a small glass or two of the stuff in their time, and as Raymond and Norman from the band explain, they've even taken the spiritual trek to Devon.
Buckfast Abbey. We went down on a pilgrimage, and we bought the key rings and the pens, and they've got all that stuff there, you know. And we bought a bottle of Buckfast, you know, from Source. And I tell you what, it's a pretty impressive place. Definitely made quite a bit of money from the people in Lanarkshire.
The Buckfast drinkers of Lanarkshire should go and check out where the money's gone, because it's definitely built a pretty nice complex.
Yeah, you know, it's a really smart place.
A few people have compared it to absinthe in the same way that that worked to open the third eye or the mind's eye of Renaissance painters.
You know, I don't know. I mean, it's good for fighting, you know. if you want to go out and sort of have a fight on a Friday night, then Buckfast will sort you out. I can't imagine Oscar Wilde drinking it anyway.
Instead of being like, I have nothing to declare but my genius, it could have been like, who are you like that?
See a good night in Lanarkshire? Get a bottle of wine, knock a motor, get the Floyd right in the jukebox, got the back roads and burn it out. That's what inspires music, fellas. See, when you see the flames, you know, you hear the Floyd in your head, and you just know to shine on. You just see exactly what the truth's all about.
It's easy to laugh and dismiss Mogwai's humour, or that of the fan club, or any of the other bands from the area. But perhaps the humour is one of the things that unites them and sets them apart from other British bands. Lanarkshire humour certainly affects aspects of the band's music. Plasmatron from Mogwai.
Well, we called our album Mogwai Young Team. Do you know what I mean? It doesn't get funnier than that. Do you mean talk about a joke going too far? As you well know, like every kind of like the Edelweiss Young Team or whatever, it's kind of like a gang, kind of like a downgraded version of the Crips and the Bloods. Very downgraded. Folks stabbing each other because they live in a different scheme half a mile away. Right? It's shite. It's shite.
There are people going hungry. Nothing on their face, and you're filling your fat face with every different kind of cake. If you ever...
In a one-time unemployment black spot, with few venues, little or no opportunity for youth, high alcoholism, and violent attacks a regular occurrence, some amazing music has been produced. But perhaps it's not despite these conditions, but because of them. Dave Grohl and Norman Blake from Teenage Fan Club.
There's probably something in that. You know, maybe if you come from a really grim place, you don't want to make really negative, grim music. You want to make something that's opposite. It's a pretty small area, you know, so you get to know people, you know, and it's not as competitive as it maybe is in London, which is good, I think, you know. You don't have the kind of petty jealousies that you might have in other places.
I think that an artist's atmosphere or environment definitely influences their work. The crime, violence, drugs, and unemployment, and people will probably look within themselves and find some kind of beauty or something delicate, something real and fragile, and maybe that's what makes its way out.
So perhaps what's wrong with Lanarkshire is what makes it so right for making music. And we'll try and coax a final comment from Plasmatron from Mogwai. Or Stuart, as I prefer to think of him.
There's nothing going on. There's no, like, wee guys starting nights playing records. There's nothing going on. And, like, when we did our album in Hamilton at the KM19 studios, honestly, it was just full of wee bams playing Oasis and Manic Street Preacher songs.
Lanarkshire, it's crap, innit?
Thank you very much to Steve McKenna and the story of the Bells Hill Beat. Next week at 11 o'clock on...